I had to be around 15 or 16 when I first visited Quebec. Being in the old city, Vieux Québec, was quite a trip for the first time. Seeing all of that antiquated European architecture lining those wavy roads paved in cobblestone, it was hard to believe we were still in North America. While I have 3 semesters of French under my belt now, at the time, I knew Jacques Meld. That limited the places we can go to the touristy bits, since those were the only areas people actually spoke English. I was really bummed out by this. When I go to another country, I want to feel lost in the surroundings of a new place. I'm always looking for that "this isn't Kansas anymore" feeling, if you catch my drift. I don't like being constantly reminded that I'm a tourist and everyone around me is going to speak my language and show me exactly what they think I want to see. Halfway through the trip, though, I saw that there were a few interesting exhibits at the local art museum, Le Musée National du Beaux-Arts du Québec. Finally, I thought, maybe this is the non-tourist catering experience I was looking for. I dragged my family there the next morning. At the museum, there was a special exhibit that featured the works of one artist, Carl Tran. At the time, I was unfamiliar with his name, so I was very interested. Something about his art had to be unique if he gets his own exhibit. The showcase was titled Parce qu'il y a la nuit, or Because There is Night. What I saw were graphite engravings, pencil sketches, and neon lights spelling out words and phrases in French. Slowly I realized that not all of it was in French. There were pieces in Italian, German, and even English. I didn't really know what to make of it all. What was he trying to say? Finally, at the end of the exhibit, there was a black room. Upon walking inside, I was hit with the flash of a neon light, buzzing on and off in rainbow colors, blaring words at me I couldn't understand. But the emotions they sent through me spoke volumes. I just remember sitting there entranced, worshiping their neon dance, ignorant of their message, but enlightened by their glow. It was the first time a piece of abstract art really shook me. It was the first time I looked at something and said, "I don't get it, but I want to." When I left that room, I knew I needed to know more. I found a book on the artist in the gift shop, hopeful that it would help me crack the code of those neon signs. And that book is right here with me today. You know, I find it kind of poetic that I found Carl Tran's art when and where I did. You know, in a foreign city, surrounded by an estranged language that I basically knew nothing of at the time, it was almost the perfect environment to experience his art for the first time. But that leads me to my next point. What is Carl Tran's art actually about? What is he trying to say? Well, the best way to show you that would be to give you an example.
Here is a performance he did for Label 201 using white graphite and a blackboard. He begins by writing the French word bouleversement at the far left of the board. Bouleversement can be translated into English as upheaval, but keep that in mind. It can be translated as upheaval. With the use of a French to Italian dictionary, Tran then branches out and writes all the different words bouleversement corresponds to in Italian, in which he gets multiple possible translations. He then finds the French words that those Italian words could translate to and writes them down, and so on and so forth. By the end, he has a blackboard with hundreds of words written out, all with different meanings stemming from the same word like a family tree. Think of this performance as a more artistic version of that game people play with Google Translate, where they start with one phrase and cycle through a bunch of different translations until a completely different sentence is outputted. While it may seem like a pointless exercise in semantics, this performance demonstrates something not many of us think about when it comes to language. Translation is not a process of decoding and matching words. Sure, une fleur bleue directly means a blue flower in French, but that's only because a blue flower is a physical thing that we can observe. When different languages are describing ideas, words like upheaval, eternity, time and space, we shouldn't expect the same one-to-one correspondence. There can be multiple possible translations, homonyms, different parts of speech, or no translation at all. Languages come from different times, different places, from vastly different cultures and historical contexts, and Carl Tran's art attempts to explore and interrogate those differences. Something he says during the bouleversement performance also gives us a great window into the meaning behind his art.
So this word bouleversement, I chose it mostly because I did a residency in Rome and I was interested in the writings of the futurists, but also in the context in which they were. So just before the First World War and during and after, it was a time of bouleversement.
Carl Tran chose the word bouleversement because of how often it was used in futurist writings during and after World War I. In many cultures, some words can't be removed from their historical context, maybe because they were used a lot during a specific period or to describe a certain time. Or perhaps the words come from an era so traumatizing to a nation that their mere utterance triggers a deeply painful emotional response in its people.
One of Carl Tran's pieces sums this phenomenon up perfectly. Sept, le mot le plus terrible du National Socialism. Or, seven, the most terrible words of National Socialism. Tran made this piece by finding seven words commonly used in Nazi vocabulary throughout World War II. He then superimposed the letters on the same plane and sketched out the resulting shapes in graphite. Their twisted, warped forms and violently sharp edges are unsettling, looking more like carved-out windows into a pitch-black void than actual letters. The typeface Tran used is called Frankfurt, an old German font that harkens back to the late 19th and early 20th centuries, very commonly used in Nazi propaganda. Words that drove humans to commit unspeakable crimes should in themselves look like unspeakable words. Another one of Tran's pieces is titled Tout le monde nécessaire. It's a series of graphite blocks engraved with selected words from Jorge Semprún's autobiography, Quel beau dimanche, which tells the story of his time in Buchenwald. The title translates to All the Necessary Words, because they come from a list Jorge wrote of the essential German words one must know if you want to survive a concentration camp. Arbeit, Scheiße, Brot, Rivière, Schnell. A list of seemingly innocent vocab words, almost like one you would see in a school German class, blackened by the time and place they came from. To Jorge Semprún and his contemporaries, these simple words cannot be removed from the inhumanity of the Nazis. They cannot mean anything other than the pain and suffering endured by the victims of the Third Reich. For the people who enjoy learning languages, myself included, it comes as a stark reminder that many others throughout history weren't afforded the luxury of choosing how and when to do so. While Carl Tran uses the German language to bring to life the darker sides of the past, he also uses German in some of his art to comment on its unique structure and how it relates back to translation. This piece perfectly illuminates just how interesting and frustrating languages can behave when you attempt to translate them. Doppelgänger, a word English speakers should be familiar with. If you have a living, breathing, exact copy of yourself running around who may or may not be evil, that's a doppelgänger. However, this word is so fundamental and rooted in its Germanic origins that it encounters a lot of trouble crossing over into French. Double, souci, is written below, which appears to be the closest possible equivalent. Double, meaning double, and souci, meaning look-alike, roughly speaking. While they come close, these two French terms can never hope to express the same idea Doppelgänger does with the ease of a single word. This lack of equivalence is represented by contrasting colors and textures within the piece. Bernard Schutze, in an article he wrote for the Quebec magazine Spirale, had this to say about Tran's art. This act thus gives rise to a permanent tension between two versions of a text that can never correspond, either from a semantic or stylistic standpoint. It is in this act and the attendant tension that are central to the works of Carl Tran. This matter is complicated further when you realize the different implications each phrase has within their own linguistic culture. Doppelgänger in German literally means a double walker. In more superstitious times, the word implied a supernatural or malicious intent, that some otherworldly force is creating the apparition of a person who already exists. I know my doppelganger is evil and wants to kill and replace me, but souci in French doesn't carry the same weight. Souci means look-alike or sharing the same likeness. Elvis Presley and Marilyn Monroe impersonators are look-alikes, but my clone, who only gets closer every second I'm not running, that's a doppelganger. While German and French may share a lot of linguistic qualities, it would be wrong to assume they have perfect equivalence when it comes to translation. They have wildly different syntax and sentence structures that cause issues even when dealing with a single word. To reuse the example from before, translating a blue flower, une fleur bleue, into German, yeah, that's simple, eine blaue Blume. But with how German grammar is able to build compound words with multiple prefixes and suffixes, translating Rindfleischetikettierungsüberwachungsaufgabenübertragungsgesetz is not going to be that easy. And we're only talking about two geographically close European languages here. Imagine the problems linguists encounter while trying to translate things in Russian like the novels of Tolstoy, the Hindi and Tamil lyrics of Indian classical music, or the Chinese philosophical writings of Chuangzi and Laozi. Imagine the issues that come up when we attempt to translate sacred religious texts from hundreds or even thousands of years in the past. What is form, that is emptiness. What is emptiness, that is form. This phrase is from one of the most treasured and beloved sutras in all of Buddhist scripture. In Sanskrit, it is called the Prajnaparamhita Hridaya,
In Tibetan, Chom Den Dema Sherab Chi Parul Tu Chin Pin Ying Po. We English speakers, however, refer to it by its popular Chinese name, Xian Jing, or the Heart Sutra. The Heart Sutra is considered the paramount text on Mahayana Buddhist philosophy, explaining the doctrine of shunyata, the belief that all phenomena are ultimately empty. Buddhists believe that the physical world is an illusion. All senses and experiences are created solely by our minds, and everything that happens, has happened, or ever will happen. Every living being, thought, and feeling is in reality nothing. It's a little scary to think about, but the idea behind the Heart Sutra is that true comprehension of this nothingness will release one from the painful cycle of life and death. The sculpture above this piece not only makes a thoughtful reference to Zen Buddhist art, but it serves almost as a visual aid for the Heart Sutra. Form is emptiness. Emptiness is form. What is form that is emptiness? What is emptiness that is form? As humans, we define things by what they are, but also by what they are not. If you have a blue flower, then that means it can't be a red flower or a blue sky. We've ruled those possibilities out simply by calling it a blue flower. But that flower will one day die, dispersing its atoms back into the universe to become part of so many other things. Its molecules might enrich the soil where a red flower will grow, while its oxygen and carbon particles fill the air in the morning sky. As far as Buddhism is concerned, these forms that we see, the physical borders that separate one thing from everything else, are temporary products of human imagination. If Buddhists believe that all interpretations of the world are created in our minds, and in reality nothing we see is truly how it exists, then the same must apply to our languages. Language also exists in our minds, and words are merely interpretations of reality, not reality itself. Something else I would like to note about this piece is the final panel at the bottom. It shows the two sentences superimposed over each other, melding form and emptiness together to create one shape. Carl Tran does this for a few of his pieces, crossing two ideas over each other to symbolize a coherency and meaning. You can see him do the same thing here with the Italian words for time and space, making a subtle nod to Einstein's theory of relativity, that time and space are both two parts of the same whole, acting upon an object as one force. In a way, it sort of challenges the idea of even having two separate words to describe things that are theoretically the same. Time and space, form and emptiness. Why do these words need to be different if they both kind of mean the same thing? These logical paradoxes, where our words seem to contradict and complement each other at the same time, are where Carl Tran's art thrives the most. The exhibition the Heart Sutra piece is from is titled La Nuit est aussi un soleil, or The Night is Also a Sun. Thematically, Tran's art seeks to illuminate the infinite ways an idea can be perceived, even if their attributes seem as incomparable as day and night. Take this piece, for example, Wo viel Licht ist auch viel Schatten. The title comes straight from Johann Wolfgang von Goethe's play Gutz von Berlichingen. It means, where there is great light, there is also great shadow. The sketches depict a 19th century woman seemingly creating light out of thin air. The movement blur around her hands suggests the action is sudden, extremely fast, happening only moments before she pulls the curtains in front of her, suggesting a sense of mystery, almost as if she had just revealed to you forbidden knowledge. Notice that some of the darkest areas of these sketches fall in direct opposition of the light source, not only demonstrating Carl Tran's excellent skills as a draftsman, but also brilliantly bringing to life his message. While light and darkness seem to exist as opposites, one cannot exist without the other. The darkness is only as deep as the light around it is bright.
Now, so far, Carl Tran has taught us that while our words and their definitions are basically set in stone, the real world is much more ambiguous. It's much more confusing, and there are so many different ways that you can look at things that it almost seems as though trying to use language impedes us. I mean, words don't accurately describe anything, really, and it almost seems as though they hold us back. But is that really true? I mean, is language a wall blocking our forward motion, or is it a tool to help us get over that wall? I mentioned at the beginning of the video that Carl Tran's Boulevers du Monde performance is based on the writings of the futurists during and after World War II and just kind of brushed past it without any further elaboration. That being said, what is futurism? And how does it reflect back on Carl Tran?
Futurism began with one man, Filippo Tommaso Marinetti. A charismatic Italian poet and journalist, he found humble success within the European art scene. However, his life changed the day his vehicle swerved sharply into a ditch to avoid hitting two cyclists on the road. Lying in that dirt hole, sitting in the still silence of his own thoughts, Marinetti wasn't traumatized or in a state of shock. Rather, he was inspired by the mechanical ferocity that his automobile displayed in almost ending his life. The on-road tussle between old technology and new innovations in transport gave him an idea, and thus futurism was born. A movement that challenged and rejected all preconceived notions of art and beauty, putting technology over tradition and societal progress over culture. A style that celebrated speed, engineering, and violence. In 1909, Marinetti penned the Futurist Manifesto, a scathing and passionate rebuttal of the laissez-faire nature of modern Italian culture. Marinetti wanted his countrymen and all of Europe to cease ruminating on the past and look to the possibilities the future held for inspiration. Selected phrases from Marinetti's manifesto were borrowed by Carl Tran and illuminated with life in this piece, Notte Elettrica, Electric Night. To the best of my knowledge, the phrases translate as follows. We are also machines. We have thought. We feel mechanically. Eternal speed. While this is just a static image of the light show, the piece becomes so much more abrasive and intense when you view it in person. The strobe-like sporadic colors and the electronic hum write a love letter to Felipe Marinetti in every flash, with all of the speed and technological prowess that he would have loved to see in life. However, light cannot exist without the shadow, and there is so much more to Marinetti and the futurist movement that are inscribed on the darkest pages of history. Art, in fact, can be nothing but violence, cruelty, and injustice. Marinetti viewed war and conflict as necessary factors in the creation of the great future utopia he had in mind. His fervent nationalism and blatant hatred for contemporary European thought unfortunately made him good bedfellows with one of Italy's most notorious leaders, Benito Mussolini. Filippo Marinetti and the Futurist movement would eventually go on to play an important role in Mussolini's fascist regime. Carl Tran's Notte Elettrica is almost always displayed alongside another one of his works, Lamps, Marinetti, Mussolini. Standing before the neon signs of futurism's hopeful plans of enlightenment are the visages of the men who used them for political gain and propaganda, Filippo Marinetti and Benito Mussolini. Their illuminated glass heads resemble the form of Renato Bertelli's 1933 sculpture, Profilo Continuo, Testa di Mussolini, which is, as the title states, a continuous profile of Il Duce himself. The identical portrayal of these two men allude to their similarity in thought, visualizing how their different occupations and places in society shared the same common goal. Their contrasting placement, however, tells a different story. Mussolini is positioned upside down, mirroring the state his body was displayed in when anti-fascist partisans executed him in 1945. Marinetti, however, is standing straight up, more alive and active than the swinging cadaver before him, suggesting that he has more left to say about futurism and the coming mechanized human beings, despite its disastrous outcome for Italy. In the words of Bernard Schutze once again, Carl Tran reveals the paradox inherent in the futurist stance. While they adulated the enlightening advances of modern technology such as neon signs, electricity, and the automobile, conceived at the time as a means of drawing Europe from the light, the futurists supported at the same time the destructive forces of Italian fascism. These two pieces by Carl Tran, brimming with history and luminescent speed, hold a special place in my heart. Seeing these light displays in the Quebec Art Museum as an ignorant, overboard teenager, it invigorated my passion for understanding, for looking deeper into the things we're presented with and finding what is really there. Years later, I've finally taken that practice back to the source, to question and interrogate the art that taught me how to question and interrogate. And what did I learn from Carl Tran? Our words define who we are, who we aren't, and who we want to become. Language is complicated. It's what divides us. It's what brings us together. It gives us the ability to record history, to look back and understand our ever-changing culture and civilization, and posit what our future could look like. But with all of this power that writing gives us, it's easy to forget that there are so many things that words cannot do justice. And as isolating as that fact feels, none of language's limiting factors could ever take away your ability to imagine.
You are the creator of the shadow behind you, while you stand basking in the glory of the morning sunrise. You lie between all that humanity is and is not. So what are you gonna say? Who are you going to become?
Thank you.